Ladies and gentlemen, put your mobile phones into silent mode. The show begins right now.
It's 6 o'clock. It's time for you guys to raise the roof a little bit louder. Let me try that again. Good evening, Kiev! Perfect. You're in a real treat for your next speaker here at the Star Stage Barometer 2019. She cracks me up every time I meet her. I'm laughing now. Catherine Abels is a global brand ambassador for all things agave. Pure agave love for all things mezcal and tequila. She spends over 250 days a year traveling the world. And actually, you can hear all about tequila and mezcal tomorrow in one of the talks downstairs. But today, from all her travels and learnings, she's going to be talking about how to stay sane and healthy in this modern age of bartending. So can I ask you to get to your feet? Let's show a huge Kiev welcome to Catherine Abels!
Step inside, walk this way, you and me, babe.
Wow, okay. I didn't really expect so many people. You know what's actually quite ironic? I'm here today to talk to you about staying healthy, and it's the first time in I don't know how many years that I'm actually sick myself. So, sorry for that. Little bit stupid, because I haven't been listening to my own advice lately. So I was about to actually cancel this trip, and I'm kind of glad I didn't, even though I'm in a lot of pain. So actually I might have to sit down later, because I have a kidney infection. Anybody who's had a kidney infection here before? Kidney infection? Yeah? Oh, there's so much smoke here, I can't even see you. So if you've had one before, you know that you have very much pain in the back. I don't speak Russian, I'm sorry. It also means you're peeing blood, TMI, I don't know, and you have to go to the bathroom every 10 minutes. So it's a great combination for being on stage. Now my microphone is also dying already. Oh, this is great, isn't it? So it's a great combination, but I thought, okay, I can cancel this and be like, okay, look after myself, which would have been a good idea. But also I thought, okay, maybe this is even more so a reason to come here and to at least help you not make the same mistakes as I did lately, because seriously, I didn't listen to my own advice. And I'm going to go into that, what exactly that means, not listening to my own good advice later. But hold on. I have to orientate myself here on the stage. First of all, I'm going to tell you a little bit about me, maybe, so you know why I'm actually here talking about this topic at all. Because, as we've just heard, normally I'm a brand ambassador for alcohol, for spirits, for tequila, mezcal, which in my opinion is the most healthy spirits, of course, but I'll talk to you about that tomorrow. But first of all, this is me, normally, when I look healthy. There's one thing I would ask you as well, first of all. I know it's a bit difficult with the translations because it takes like 5 to 10 seconds until everything's translated, but I'm sure most of you also speak English, right? Yeah, who speaks English? Yeah, you all speak English, I know. I've been here last year and everybody spoke English very well. And actually everybody asked a lot of questions, so that's why I'm actually trying to maybe stop at 30 minutes, 40 minutes maximum, which is kind of hard for me because I love talking normally when I'm not in pain. But I'm sure I'll get into it today as well. So please stop me at 30 to 40 minutes because I want you to be able to ask some questions as well, right? Because normally, this topic I don't talk about in presentations. Normally what I do is I consult people one-on-one. So this is actually how it all started. As I said, I've been a brand ambassador for 2.5 years now, and I've been working in hospitality for 15 years now. So a long time. Someone from the first row, hi Asad, he already asked me, how old are you? And I'm 35. So I'm still alive. Maybe I only turned 40, but you never know. So I've been working in this in 5 kilos. And he was hospitalized in life-threatening conditions twice in this time. And I swore to myself, that's not going to happen to me. And I started taking actions on how to, you know, live fast and die young, but maybe be healthy before you die. So maybe I die at 40. But at least I'm going to be healthy when I die at 40. So, no, just kidding. You know what I mean. I swore to myself I'm not going to make the same mistakes as him, and I'll find out ways on how to do it. And other people from the industry started figuring out or started noticing, ah, Catherine is doing maybe some things wrong. She still looks like she's kind of like not putting on 35 kilos. I haven't in the last 2 years, so something must be working. And she hasn't been hospitalized yet. So there's something she's doing right. And people started asking me for help and for consulting. So I started doing that. And then at some point I figured out, okay, if I really want to do this, I also have to start training as like, you know, like a healthcare professional as well. So I'm doing that on the side as well. Not because in healthcare they tell you all the cool, great hacks, because they don't. But it gives you some sort of legitimization. But putting that aside, I'm not a doctor. I'm not a physician or anything, so I can't give you like proper medical advice. If you have any kind of condition, like a health condition or anything, you always have to ask a doctor first. What I'm trying to do here today is just show you what I do personally and what I tell my colleagues that I want to help on what they can do. And this is not going to be crazy expensive things like injecting stem cells into your dick or buying super expensive red light therapy tools for at home that cost $10,000 or something. That's all super great, and that is stuff that definitely works. There's a lot of studies out on all of these biohacking tools. Who's heard the term biohacking before? You have? Biohacking? Yeah, somebody there? Yeah, somebody there. So a couple of you have heard of this. Biohacking is a term that is a little bit difficult, but it basically means everything you can do with tools or without tools to get a fast way on how to improve everything that your body does. Yeah. So some things are as simple as, I don't know, taking a cold shower, and other things are extremely high technology advanced, like stem cell therapy, for example. I'm not going to go into this, as I said before, because this is something that we probably all of us won't get the chance to do ever. What I'm trying to tell you today is 10 things that are very easily implemented in a schedule that is as crazy as ours and what you can do on a daily basis. So don't expect rocket science, but expect little changes that will make a relatively high impact in your life if you follow it. And I know there's a lot of bartenders who want to burn the candle at both ends. And I have been like this, and I still am sometimes, and I also still have a lot of colleagues and friends who are like this, you know, rock and roll and loving the lifestyle and going out and crazy and everything. And that's totally fine. I don't judge that. And I think that's great. And as I said, I still love doing that too. But I assume you also want to be a little bit responsible while you do that. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here, right? So some things I say, you might be like, what is she talking about? That crazy hippie girl on stage? Because I am a bit of a hippie. And you can judge me all for that. But if you only take one thing from today, I'm totally fine. And if you, sorry, this is getting a little bit out of hand here. All right. I hope you can still hear me. I think so. So yeah, you can judge. Ooh, that's a bit too loud maybe. Okay. Not only am I sick, but also the microphone is sick. Anyway. So you can judge me for that, but maybe you take one or two things that will actually help you. So, as you can see, that's me when I look healthy at the moment. That's just what we're going to talk about later. I'm assuming you're feeling pretty relaxed right now. You've had a couple of drinks already. It's a Saturday. Is it Saturday? Yeah, I think it's Saturday. A Saturday where you might not... Is it Saturday, right? Yeah, you know what it's like. We never know what day of the week it is. Who doesn't have to work later on? Ah, good on you. So I'm assuming you're feeling pretty relaxed. That's great. But you know what? You're all going to die of stress anyway. Unless you're lucky enough to die in a quick accident and just be dead. That would be a good way to die. What do I mean by that? We're all going to die of stress. Well, basically, aging and disease is nothing else than you and your cells being stressed. Stress, okay, one thing maybe in advance. This is not going to be super scientific, first of all, because I'm not a scientist, but also we don't have the time. But if you have detailed questions later on, we can talk about that. But I'm just going to make it quite simple. So what I mean when I say we're all going to die of stress is every time your cells reproduce, there's a little bit of material information getting lost. And that is due to outer stressors that change the way your DNA is, basically said. So whenever we are stressed, whenever we produce stress hormones like cortisol or adrenaline or so on, that kills our cells a little bit every time. And this is something you can't really do anything against, but you can slow that process down. And this is what's slowing also down your aging process. And basically everything we're going to talk about today is based on this assumption. Stress and inflammation. Inflammation, I don't know what the word for it in Ukrainian or Russian is, but it basically means everything that is like... for example, when you're sick, when you have a fever, your cells are inflamed. And this is happening throughout your body all the time. And inflammation isn't necessarily always a bad thing. There's also good ways of inflammation. So, for example, when you go to the gym, yeah, and when you do like weightlifting and shit, what happens? The microfibers basically in your muscles, they break, they inflame for a short time. And they scar, micro scars. And those micro scars, due to the inflammation, they increase muscle growth. So basically, a growing muscle is nothing else than a scar tissue that keeps building up. And of course, when you want to be a bulky weightlifter, that's amazing. You want that. But on the other hand, it's also responsible for all the aging and for all the disease that we have in our body. So most of the time, what we want to do is decrease the inflammation. That's actually also a thing. With all the tips I give you here today, you're not going to be a world-class elite athlete and you're not going to be a bodybuilder. You're not going to look like a bodybuilder after you do all these tips. But it's because it's often like that, that if you want to increase lifespan or healthy living, you have to decrease performance a little bit. It's really hard to do both at the same time. So if you want to be an elite athlete, you're probably going to die maybe 5 years earlier. But hey, it's a cool way of dying because at least you were a super runner or a super weightlifter or something. But you kind of have to choose between the two. So inflammation is usually what we want to reduce. That's actually me 5 years ago when I was still doing Olympic weightlifting on a competitive level. So I was training 5 to 6 days a week for around 2 to 3 hours in Olympic weightlifting. You know what that is? Like that kind of thing, you know, with weights and stuff. I was doing that. And I thought I was super healthy. And I looked kind of healthy, but I was sick and unhappy all the time. And now, basically 5 years after, I know why that is. Because I was just putting too much stress and inflammation into my body. I had a lot of muscles, but also that increased the inflammatory markers in my body. And now I know it's not good for me to actually work out so much. And that's one of the reasons why I'm sick now. A couple of weeks ago, I agreed to do a heavy lifting workout, first time in like 3 or 4 years, after doing a guest shift at a friend's bar and being really drunk. So the next morning, I got up and did a heavy weightlifting workout and a CrossFit workout. It was super stupid, and now I'm sick. There you go. So this is one of the mistakes you can learn from. So we want to reduce the stress and inflammation. And everything we're going to talk about now is aimed at reducing this. So, okay, now it gets really hippie. Are you still with me? Okay, good. Because actually, this is... Ooh, okay, you're really with me. Wow. This is my beautiful feet. Sorry for showing you my feet, but I needed some pictures that I can use without being sued. So I took my own private pictures. And I do that all the time. I'm the crazy girl you can see walking barefoot in the middle of the city. I know, I'm a hippie. But there's scientific proof behind it. And it's pretty easy to understand. Basically, the whole planet, the Earth, is charged with electrons, mobile electrons, that are floating around freely. Yeah, it's the negative charge of the Earth. And normally, when we are being a healthy human being, like we have been for the last, I don't know, 200,000 years, we are connected to the Earth all the time. That means our body charge, electromagnetic charge of the body is the same as the Earth. And that's what keeps our, basically our magnetic field and the body stable. And we're only just figuring out in the last 60 to 70 years that this bioelectrical stability is super important for our health. And if it's disrupted, we are prone to degenerative disease like diabetes, like coronary heart diseases, depression, and all of those terrible things we don't want to have. Why did that start 60 to 70 years ago? Because we started being indoors, being surrounded by airplanes, being surrounded by cars, and wearing rubber soles on our shoes. And what does rubber do? It insulates you from the ground. That means our bodies can't be charged with the negative ions that we need. Yeah, I know it sounds really crazy and really hippie, but there's actually a lot of studies behind this. And if you know a little bit about physics, it's kind of easy to understand even. So basically, if you forget everything else I'm going to say later on, if you keep one thing in mind, it's being grounded. It's charging your body with negative ions. And it's pretty easy to do, actually. All you need to do is, ideally every day, take off your shoes for 30 minutes and be outside. On the soil, on lawn, on rocks. Concrete is fine too, but avoid asphalt. Yeah, because asphalt is a mix of tar and usually plastic or rubber pieces. So that has an insulating effect as well. But everything that is kind of like a rocky or soil material will be connected to the earth and will have mobile electrons that will charge your body with the right negative ions. Why 30 minutes? Your body takes around depending on your size, 22 to 25 minutes to go through a full blood cycle. So the time your blood needs to revolve throughout your body. So to be safe and have all of your blood charged, we say take time for 30 minutes. And while you're at it, you might as well just be outside in nature. Because what trees especially do is they exude or they evaporate certain terpenes that we know from essential oils, for example, that have a beneficial effect on your heart rate, on your blood pressure. They lower the blood pressure in your body and improve your mood. So it's really good. It's a really good antidepressant. And the last thing is show your skin and skip the sunglasses. I know skin cancer is a thing, and we all want to protect our skin with sunscreen to avoid wrinkles and stuff. I wear sunscreen and everything on my face at least, but I try to make sure to have my skin exposed every day at least a little bit, even if it's overcast. Because what happens is, both in your eyes and in your skin, you have photoreceptors that are responsible for producing both melanin and melatonin. Melanin is the stuff that keeps your skin protected against skin cancer. So if you wear sunglasses and sun protection the whole time, your body doesn't produce enough melanin. And then you will be even more prone to actually getting skin cancer. And the same goes for the melatonin production, melatonin being the hormone that is responsible for proper sleep and for a proper circadian rhythm, which is the natural sleep pattern that your body normally has and tells you when to go to bed, when to be tired, when to wake up, and so on. And those things are regulated by natural sunlight. So you have to go out. You have to be outside. And I know sunglasses are cool and shit, but just take them off, unless it's like you have to drive a car or something, of course. Safety first. Ooh. I don't know. Let me just check. Whew. See, I'm already talking way too much than I actually thought. I'm trying to keep it really short. This is a very interesting topic because, of course, when it comes to diet and eating, people have a lot of opinions and they always ask me, so do I have to be a vegan? Do I have to do a ketogenic diet? Do I have to be a paleo diet person or something? And I always say there is no such thing as a perfect diet. Yeah, it always comes down to DNA. Blood and microbiome testing. Microbiome being the gut flora of your body, basically, but also the flora on your skin, which it's not so easy to test. But basically, it's the preconditions that you have in your body and your DNA. And depending on your DNA, you will have totally different reactions to food. So you can't say fatty foods are good for you or carbohydrates are good for you. It always depends on your DNA. And you can do genetic testing with this, and I actually believe at the same time while I'm speaking, there's a young lady talking about DNA testing, and her company is called MyHelix. She's here at the barometer as well. I think her name is Daria or something. And companies like that, they do DNA testing, and they will find out for you what a good diet for you will be from a DNA, from a genetic or epigenetic standpoint. But if you don't want to get so nerdy, there's a couple of things that everybody can do, I believe, that will keep everybody a little bit more healthy. First is use common sense and look at your ancestors. Where do your ancestors come from? Are your ancestors from, I don't know, the equatorial region and from a hot climate where there has been a lot of, where there's always a lot of fruit and vegetables available throughout the year? Then it's quite likely that from a DNA standpoint, you are very good at metabolizing carbohydrates. But if you are maybe from Iceland or from Eastern European region like we are, me as well, my family is from Russia and Estonia, then it's probably most likely that our ancestors used to eat a lot of meat and a lot of fatty fish. So we are better at doing something like a ketogenic diet, which is heavily fat and protein based. So this is small things that you keep in mind. Second thing is super simple, avoid processed food. I don't think I have to tell that anybody anymore, right? You all know that. When it comes in a box and it doesn't look like food anymore, it's probably not so clever to eat it. So another thing is, which has been demonized very much in the food industry for the last 40 years, is fat. People tell you if you eat fat, you get fat. It's not true. You have to eat healthy fats. healthy fats being, depending on your DNA, something like a grass-fed butter or a good lard, coconut oil, good quality vegetable oil like avocado or olive. Bad fats are everything that is processed in an industrial way which changes the molecular structure of the fats, like margarine, for example, or hydrolyzed vegetable oils, stuff like that. Because for your body, basically, you could as well eat plastic. The molecular structure of those fats are changed, and your body doesn't know what to do with that. Yeah. So this is kind of where you have to divide between the fats. But in general, eat healthy fats, because if you don't eat fat, what's going to happen, especially for the men, it's quite actually for both genders, but I always say for the men, it's terrible because it lowers your testosterone. And who wants that, right? Shrivel dick? We don't want. Okay. Next thing is, I know you're all, this is very controversial, and you're all going to say like, oh God, this is such a hipster thing to say, avoid gluten and dairy. But yeah, it's a wise idea to avoid gluten and dairy. I'm terribly sorry, and I'll explain to you in a second. But also, be easy on the sugars. If you're a super athlete and you're burning through a lot of calories every day because you're running a triathlon every day, have your sugar. I don't give a fuck. But in general, sugar is not so much a good idea, especially when it comes in the form of juice. Sounds counterintuitive, doesn't it? Because we always think, oh, juice cleanse and juices and everything, celery juice, it's super healthy. But nature had a very good idea when it put sugars together with fibers, fruit, right? But if you take a fruit and if you squeeze it and get the juices out, you are only left with the fructose and maybe some vitamins, but they are not so stable most of the time, so I'm not sure if that's such a good idea. So when you're removing the fiber, even though the sugar content doesn't really change, but without the fiber, your body metabolizes the sugars differently. So it doesn't know what to do exactly with all those sugars. And that raises your blood sugar levels, which is something we definitely want to avoid. I'll talk about that in a second. So you can also imagine if you drink like a smoothie or a juice, you're easily ingesting 2 bananas and 5 oranges, right? If you go to a juice bar, super easy. But think again. Would you eat 2 bananas and 5 oranges for breakfast? You probably wouldn't, because you would start feeling very full and very sick because of the fiber. And this is how nature intended fruit to be eaten. Don't make it too easy for your body. Don't remove the fiber. All right? Dairy and gluten. I don't care. Sometimes it's really nice to be with your family, eat traditional foods, eat some pelmeni, whatever. And you have your dairy and your gluten. That's totally fine. But use it as a condiment. Use it as something that is like a special occasion, because especially with dairy, there is a problem to it. When we eat cow's milk, we are not really suited to it. I don't have any problem, like I'm not a vegan or anything. I used to be, but I'm not anymore. I don't necessarily have a problem with eating meat or dairy products. But it depends on what you want. And you have to keep in mind that dairy is something designed to make baby cows grow as fast as possible, right? We're neither baby cows, nor do we want to grow as fast as possible when we're already adults, right? Because growing in that sense means basically getting fat. Because when you look at the makeup of milk, it's designed basically in the same terms as ice cream is designed. The sugar, the combination of sugar and fat in cow's milk, in natural cow's milk, is the same as in ice cream. So you might as well just eat ice cream. And that's made so that baby cows actually want to drink the milk to make them really grow fast and get fat. And that's what we don't really want. And with gluten, that's a very long topic, and I don't think we have enough time to get into this. But even though a lot of people that are not celiac, that don't have celiac disease, a lot of people actually react to certain compounds in plants, in glutinous plants, and also lectins in pulses that have adverse effects to their gut microbiome. So it's a wise idea to stay away from it most of the time. And as I said, I'm not a vegan, used to be, but I think eating meat is totally fine if you watch out for a couple of things. Don't combine meat with fast food. So when I say it's okay to eat meat, don't go out and eat a burger at McDonald's, but make sure you eat healthy meat. What is healthy meat? Meat by animals that have been raised eating and growing on like proper grass, that eat a lot of herbs and grass. That could be game meat, like wild boar or fowls or deer or elk or bear or whatever you want, because those actually have a different omega-3 to omega-6 fatty acid ratio in their body. We often hear that meat is unhealthy because it has a lot of saturated fatty acids. This is only true if the animal where the meat comes from was fed a lot of grains, because that changes the fatty acid structure. If it's a wild animal and it has been eating a lot of herbs and grass, it actually has a lot of omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids in its cells, so it's a lot more healthy to eat. And also what is important is eat nose to tail. I'm sure you've all come across the term nose to tail because it's really fashionable at the moment. What does it mean in this context, in a health context? Don't just eat fillet. I know it's yummy. And also don't just eat entrecote. I know that's yummy too. You have to eat everything of the animal. That means you have to eat the collagen. You have to eat the offals. You have to eat the heart and tongue and, you know, all those very unpopular cuts of the animal. But what does it do? It has a lot of different other fatty acids and essential amino acids as well. Without these essential amino acids, we are deprived of a lot of healthy compounds of the meat. And this is the reason why people think meat is unhealthy, because they only focus on one certain part of the body. But if we eat like our ancestors did, using everything from the animal, this is a healthy way of eating meat. You get all the good stuff from the meat. And you get used to eating offal after a while. I like brain. Actually, last time I had brain was in Kiev. I like tongue, you know, and that's after being a vegetarian for 17 years, six of them being vegan. So if I can do it, you can do it. Be insulin sensitive. Jesus Christ, I think I really have to hurry up, right? Yeah, I have to hurry up. We're gonna run through this a bit more quickly. I'm gonna skip the insulin sensitivity. It basically means don't raise your blood sugar levels too much. We're gonna get to that later on. But fasting. Fasting is one of the most important things you can do food-wise, basically, or non-food-wise, not eating. And this is something you can do if you are a keto person or a vegetarian or whatever. Fasting helps you. Thank you, I know I have to hurry up. Fasting kicks off a process in the body called autophagy. And autophagy is responsible for cleaning up your cells. Auto meaning self, and phagos is the eating, the consuming. So self-consuming the cells that your body doesn't need anymore. And this process is kick-started for women after around 12 hours of not eating or not consuming anything, and men usually around 16 hours. So what you can do is reduce your feeding, your eating window, to a shorter amount of time. So let's say you only eat between 10 a.m. or for a bartender, maybe 12 a.m., like noon, and then eat for the next 8 hours, eat substantially, and then you don't eat until you get home and fall into a coma after working, all right? And then you eat again the next morning. This is one of the best things you can do for your health. All right, supplements. I don't really believe so much in supplements, so that's why we can go through there quite quickly. But there's a couple of things that will be beneficial to almost anybody, no matter your health condition or your current state of health. Omega-3 fatty acids, especially from marine algae, because they're the least toxin-laden ones. Collagen powder and bone broth, coming back to the nose-to-tail idea. Collagen has a very healing effect on your gut health, on your digestion, on your microbiome, on your hair, on your health, on your skin health, bone density, and all of these things. Also inflammation, it's a good inflammation reductionist. Then, super important, especially when you drink alcohol, apple cider vinegar and cinnamon. They help to keep your blood sugar levels stable. So before, actually I think I'm going to mention that later on, but before you have any kind of carbohydrate rich meal, make sure to have some apple cider vinegar, maybe in water, maybe in a salad or whatever. This is going to keep your blood sugar levels stable and your energy from crashing, and also will reduce the likelihood of getting obesity or diabetes. Super, super important. Cinnamon is the same. Some of the supplements I recommend are CBD. I checked, it's legal in Ukraine. CBD being the non-psychoactive compound of cannabis. It's a super potent anti-inflammatory agent. I take it twice a day when I get up in the morning and before I go to bed at night. Curcumin, ginger, I think especially in Eastern European countries, we all know those ingredients because they're kind of native to our regions as well. Super high antioxidants and anti-inflammatory as well. Oil of oregano is another one that you might have not heard of. It's basically the essential oil of the oregano herb, super potent. I'm taking this at the moment to help with my kidney infection. If I wouldn't be taking this, I'd probably not be here because I'd be in hospital. So I swear by that. Green tea, same thing. You can work a lot with essential oils. And I actually do that behind the bar too. I use essential oils in a lot of my cocktails. For example, grapefruit oil or lavender. And the two oils that I always have with me when I'm traveling is mint and lavender. Because, for example, when you have like an upset stomach, which often happens when you go to like foreign countries and you have to eat foreign food, you can take a couple of drops of peppermint oil, mix it with some kind of body lotion or so, put it on your belly, and I tell you, your cramps are going to go away within 10 minutes, I swear. Lavender is super good when you have like open cuts at your hand from maybe working behind the bar, or mosquito bites when you go to exotic countries or whatever, just put lavender oil on it, definitely helps. If you have cramps, I don't know, I used to have a lot of cramps from a lot of standing and walking behind the bar and being dehydrated. What you can do is, first of all, drink a lot of water. And the second thing is, if you have a cramp that doesn't go away, eat a bit of chili or a bit of salt, because those trigger the same areas in your brain that are responsible for your muscles cramping. And you trick the brain by concentrating on the saltiness and the spice, and then it forgets that it actually has a cramp. It's a great trick, I swear by it. All right, next one. Whew, gotta be fast. Movement. Start your day with a fasted, low-impact routine, if you can. If there's one thing I would always say is prioritize sleep over movement. I mean, it's always good to move throughout the day, as I'm saying here, try to move every 45 minutes, but if you're not an F&B manager, but an actual bartender, you will not have a problem with that, right? You're moving anywhere the whole day. If you're sitting in front of the desk or in front of the computer, make sure to get up every 45 minutes and do something. I don't know, 5 push-ups, 5 squats, just walk around the block, get a glass of water, whatever it is, just make sure you don't sit for 4 or 5 hours. But why low impact? It's the smartest thing to do in the morning, and I don't know what it's like for you, but often I have the choice between, and I know that's not healthy, I have the choice between 4 hours of sleep and, I don't know, 1 hour of workout or 5 hours of sleep and maybe 10 minutes of workout. And I will always go for more sleep and less workout. And I haven't properly trained in, 3 or 4 years maybe, and I still have like considerable amount of muscle. I haven't deteriorated considerably. And this is just by doing little things like this. I don't go to the gym anymore. All I do is like body weight workouts and stuff. And I still have considerable amount of muscle left from when I did weightlifting. And this is just by doing stuff like this. If you have time for a workout once a week, you can achieve quite good results with something called low frequency, high volume. It means, it's okay to only work out once a week, but you have to get all the intensity that you would normally be doing every day. Like, let's say you go to the gym every day for 30 minutes, do some lifts. Take this volume and put it all into 1 or 2 hours once a week. It will get you almost the same results, okay? And just try some new stuff every now and then. Don't get your body used to doing all the same movements again, because it will get bored and the it will mitigate the effects of the muscle response. All right, clever drinking. I think there's another person at Barometer doing a talk about how to drink alcohol clever, so I'm going to be really fast with this one as well. Learn to say no and enjoy it. Sometimes it's good to just say no. We don't always have to drink. It's really hard, I know. Whenever I go to a place, they're like, people are like, oh, now you're here and Kiev, you cannot have a drink, you know? Like, everywhere you go, people are excited you're coming, and I totally understand, and I'm super grateful that people are. But for me, this is every day. Yeah, I'm somewhere new every day of the week. And if I always go like, oh yeah, okay, I'm in Kiev now, I'll have a drink with you, then I will drink 7 days a week. And that's gonna kill me. So you have to learn to say no and stick to it. And I always say or advise, have at least 2 days of the week where you drink zero alcohol. Rather have a little bit more the next day instead of having a little bit every day, because your body needs time. Like with the fasting I mentioned earlier, your body needs time to actually detox. Detox is a difficult word, but it's true. Your body needs time to get rid of all those components. And basically, on a day that you're drinking, you can forget about anything else. If you work out on a day of drinking or you take supplements on a day of drinking, you might as well just throw it in the toilet. Okay? So make sure you have at least two days a week where you just focus on being healthy. Again, avoid sugar, avoid juices, not only for the reasons I talked to you about earlier about juices, but also juices contain fructose, and fructose is the only type of sugar that is metabolized in the liver. Liver. What happens when we drink alcohol is our liver is super busy. And once we have alcohol in the body, our liver doesn't do anything else but concentrate on the alcohol. So when you also add fructose to the mix, it can't do anything with the fructose and it gets stored in fat cells directly. What you can do is before drinking, again, use apple cider vinegar and some other components I don't have time to talk about enough. Use apple cider vinegar to keep your blood sugar stable. We talked about that. If you really want to try a proper hack this time, you can try finding nicotinamide riboside. Sometimes you can buy it on Amazon or find it online or in good pharmacies, which is a precursor for NAD, and it's a compound that has been shown in studies lately that is extremely potent in repairing cells, in DNA repair protects both your brain and your liver, which is a good thing. And it's a type of vitamin B3, and it's one of the best things you can do after drinking, especially. Very important topic, but maybe we can keep that one shorter as well. Because Eastern Europeans, we all love sauna, right? I hope so. Who loves sauna? Sauna? Yeah. Yeah, sauna. Sauna is awesome. I love sauna. This is one thing, when I go traveling, I don't really care about how fancy the hotel is, really. I try to make sure they have a sauna. Because it's shown that this is one of the most healthy things, together with fasting and good sleep and grounding, that you can do to improve overall health and health span as well. So they did a study with Finnish people, who obviously love sauna as well, with Finnish men for, I think, 20 years. And when you go to the sauna 4 to 5 times a week at around 80 to 90 degrees for around 20 minutes, you reduce all-cause mortality, so meaning any kind of way you can die naturally or by deteriorating health, is reduced by 50%. Yeah, so it's super, super, super simple. All you have to do is hang out in the sauna. Doesn't sound too bad, does it? And it has a great, great impact on your health, especially if you combine it with cold showers and cold baths. I talked about stress and inflammation being a good thing sometimes as well in the beginning. And this is the type of stress that you want in your body, because it makes you more resilient. And it makes for a process in the body called hormesis. Hormesis meaning that your body adjusts to stress and becomes more of a fighter. It can handle outside stresses better. So a controlled way of doing this is using heat and cold. It's super simple, and it stimulates your vagus nerve, which is the nerve that runs, don't touch myself so much, which runs from your head through your sternum down all the way to your spine. And this nerve is extremely important for your autonomous nervous system. And if you learn to stimulate this nerve, it will have a very good impact on all the mitochondrial functions in your body. Next one. Sounds simple, is simple, and you all need to do it. Be mindful. Be mindful of your time. I know I have to keep this simple because I want to give you at least a little bit of time to ask questions. But when you do things, be in the moment. Don't stress about things that you can't change. For example, next time you wait in line at the supermarket and there's a super stupid person in front of you that doesn't get their shit together and you're standing there like, why do I have to wait in line? You're there. You can't change anything about it unless you want to leave all your stuff in the supermarket. Take a couple of breaths, enjoy the moment, and maybe use the time to meditate. Use the time to do a breathing routine, for example, which is the next one. There's no surprise that there are some cultural techniques that have been or that are present in all cultures of the world that we know and also all religions of the world, because they have been tried and tested over centuries and thousands of years even. So one or two things that pretty much all religions have in the world are breathing or singing techniques and fasting. Fasting we already talked about, but breathing and singing. In Hinduism there's chanting. In Christian and Judaistic traditions there's a lot of singing. Then in all the Taoistic religions we have breathing techniques. And why is that? Because it is the fastest way to reduce stress hormones in your body. Back then they didn't know that, but intuitively they knew that they were doing something right. Yeah. And singing does the same because it forces you to breathe deeply. Same thing. So whenever I'm stressed or basically whenever I wake up or go to bed, I make sure I do a breathing rhythm. 8 cycles of breathing in through the nose for 4 times. So counting till 4 while I breathe in, holding the breath for 7 counts, and then breathing out through the mouth for 8 counts. And that I do 8 times. This is the first thing also I do in the morning. And the good thing about it is you can even do it when you wake up next to your Tinder date without scaring the Tinder date, because it's quite unsuspicious. So this is one of the things that I definitely advise you to do. And another thing that has dramatically changed my life and my health and happiness is being grateful and exercising gratitude. And a perfect thing to doing this is to write down things that you're grateful for every day in a gratefulness journey, a journal. So maybe start with one thing that you're grateful for every day and then work up to 3 things. And now, I've been doing this for 2 years now, it's like I want to write a whole book every night. Like, oh, I'm grateful for this and all that happened and this is cool and thank God I didn't get a parking ticket. And, you know, it really becomes something that you're looking forward to before going to bed, and it's a ritual that makes you fall asleep faster as well. So be grateful and be aware of it. Say thank you every time you realize, oh, I could have gotten a parking ticket, but I didn't get one. Awesome. And this teaches you how to really be happy. And even on days where you think everything sucks and I'm sick and everybody hates me and nobody loves me and whatever, everything went wrong, you probably have a roof on top of your head and you two have 2 legs and 2 arms left, right? That's something to be grateful for. Okay, maybe we're going to skip through this really quickly, because I don't need to tell you, we all have great social lives because we're surrounded by people every day at work and they're all our friends and we love our colleagues and we love our customers and whatnot, but make sure to have meaningful connections besides that, because you don't really get to do a lot of sober deep talk at the bar, right? Most of the time you're drunk or somebody else is drunk. So make sure you have people that you have proper connections with. And first thing I wrote down is what we can learn of the blue zones. I don't know if you've heard of the blue zones, but there are areas in the world where by statistics we have figured out that people live longer and healthier, and scientists try to find out why that is. And they focused on what they eat, how they sleep, how they behave and whatnot. And some of them have totally different things, like they eat a totally different diet, or some drink alcohol and some don't. But one thing they all have in common is they have a great sense of community and a strong sense of purpose in their life. Most of them actually are religious. I'm not religious, so I don't ask you to be, but religion gives you a sense of purpose and why you're here for on earth. Find your purpose on earth and be able to say it maybe in one sentence. I'm still working on mine, so I don't expect you to have one top of your head, but make sure you know why you're here. This is going to help you dramatically. And learning new things. That's also one thing that all the blue zones had in common. And we're going to skip through this really quickly, because basically everything that is important for sleep we already talked about. Sleep is important. We all know that because it is the time when your body repairs your cells, replenishes your hormone balances. It also helps you, well, it's important for all hormones, but there's two that are particularly interesting, especially for bartenders when you drink a lot of alcohol, and those are leptin and ghrelin. If you don't sleep enough, your leptin and ghrelin balance is thrown overboard, and those are responsible for overeating. So you all know what it's like when you drink a lot of alcohol, the next day you get super, like, nasty cravings, and this is what again then makes you get fat or unhealthy and makes you not work out. And this is produced by leptin and ghrelin, which is not working when you don't sleep enough. There's a direct link also to Alzheimer's. They found out the less you sleep, the more likely you are to get Alzheimer's. This is the number one cause for degenerative brain disease, so make sure you sleep enough. Also, sleep deprivation is like being drunk. So when you are awake for more than 17 hours, which happens to us all the time, it's like having 3 vodka tonic, okay? And you wouldn't drive a car after 3 vodka tonic, obviously. So being awake for such a long time has the same effect. Be mindful of that. Another very, very important one is be cold, but have warm feet. And photobiomodulation, I touched on that briefly. You also have photoreceptors in your skin. So when you're lying in a room, even if you have a sleeping mask on that blocks the light from your eyes, your skin also detects that there's light around you, and that disrupts your sleep. Another thing that you can do when you have trouble sleeping is what I told you about, is this gratitude journal and breathing techniques. This is something that will help you dramatically. Also for me, it was CBD. I also already mentioned that as well. And if you have serious trouble sleeping and calming down after a day at the bar and working, try weighted blankets. Weighted blankets are basically light blankets that are filled with weights that give you a feeling of heaviness on your body, and that has been shown to improve sleep dramatically as well, because it apparently reminds us of our time in the womb of our mother. All right, we don't have time for that anymore. Because I want you to be able to ask a couple of questions, but if I had to tell you 3 things that are most important of what I just said, is sleep better, love more, and take off your shoes. Thank you so much, and I'm looking forward to at least some questions. Thank you. Any questions? I have Instagram, yes. Hold on. How do I get back? Actually, I'm working on a website right now. It's not up at the moment because I have problems with my host, with my domain host. But as soon as all this information is on the website as well, with all sorts of links and tips where you can find more information and all the gadgets that you can buy if you're interested, this is all going to be on my website, and I'm going to do an Instagram post so you will not miss out. And my Instagram is, there you go, the cables. Any other questions? Why I have such a cool nickname, for example?
Да, есть вопрос. После 17 лет вегетарианской жизни.
After the 17 years of vegetarian life, why did you begin to eat meat again? What inspired you? What made you eat meat?
Yeah? You don't have?
No, I don't have a translation.
After 17 years of being a vegetarian, what made you become not vegetarian?
Good question. Poor health. My health started deteriorating, and I'm a very extreme person. So when I do something, I want to do it all the way. So one of the major things why I wanted to become a vegetarian in the first place was ethics. I didn't want to harm anybody. So at some point, I was even a fruitarian, meaning I only eat fruit that drops from the tree, that the plant gives you, I don't know how to say it, that the plant wants to give you. So you don't eat root vegetables because you kill the whole plant, for example. So totally, like, extreme. And then I figured out if I want to do no harm, then I also have to look after people. And often there's a conflict between looking after animals and people at the same time. So when I was a vegan, I would only wear like really cheap clothes that were made out of PVC and plastic and polyester and so on, not to wear wool and silk and, you know, all of these materials. But those back then, that was like 17 years ago, most of those clothes were made in very cheaply in very poor countries by children. So I had this conflict going on there. So I started rethinking everything and I figured out I can't be cruelty free in my life, but I have to pick my battles. And now what I do is I try to be really mindful of the meat I eat. For example, I would never go to McDonald's and eat a burger there. But for example, I'm doing a hunting license so I can actually kill my own animals. Because first of all, they're healthier and it's good for the environment because you have to modulate the animal populations anyway. And also it gives you a mindfulness of what you're doing. You don't just go to a supermarket and eat meat like it's nothing, but you have to actually kill the animal and know what you're doing and you become much more conservative with it. Yeah, sorry, long answer.
Thank you.
Other questions? What? I'm still working on that. I'm not a hunter yet. Still taking lessons.
Another question. Are your tips good for older people? Like, not for youth, but old generation?
I try to pick those tips so that they basically apply to anybody. Because, as I said, normally when I help people or consult people, I do one-on-one. Like, I talk to a person, I look at the individual and try to find out what their individual problem is. So then I might have different tips, but when I give tips for a whole crowd like this, I try to make sure it's something that will benefit anybody. So for example, as I said, with the food, it's hard to give advice to, you know, general advice, but something like eating unprocessed food or eating collagen, that is something that will most certainly not do harm to anybody. And I don't think any of the tips I gave today is something that people, older people, could not do. No, I think it's pretty universal. Yeah. Sorry, my earrings are making a lot of noise, right? I'm just figuring it out after an hour. Whoops.
It's fine.
More questions? Yes, please. I'm not a hunter yet. I'm training to be a hunter. So, and you can't just go out and just kill an animal even when you're training as a hunter. You have to get to a certain level. At least in Germany, it's like that. I don't know about Ukraine. Maybe it's a bit more wild. But in Germany, it's very regulated. So I haven't been allowed to shoot on animals yet. And it's a bit difficult with my schedule. So at the moment, I'm doing the theoretical part. And next year in spring, I'm going to do the practical part in a three-week course, basically. Fingers crossed.
Thank you.
Asad?
Catherine, so you said you training 10 minutes per day, yep? So which exercises is this? And which of them is your favorite?
It depends on what you want. So for me, usually all I can carve out during the day is 5 or 10 minutes in the morning. And I do like a mix of some very easy yoga moves, like a sun salutation. I do 1 minute of handstand because the inversion is also good for your blood flow and circulation. And I do 20 push-ups and a couple of jumping, I don't know what they're called, jump lunges. And then throughout the day, if I'm not moving a lot throughout the day anyway, because I'm walking a lot or I'm working behind the bar or something, I make sure that I do at least 20 push-ups every hour. I take a break, do 20 push-ups, and do, I don't know, 80 jump lunges, and then I go back to work at the desk, or I stop, you know, I'm driving in the car a lot, so I make sure that, of course, with car driving, every hour is a bit difficult, but I make sure I stop every 2 or 3 hours and do a little bit of, like, a yoga stretch or a couple of push-ups, and people start looking at you funny, but you get used to it. And when you're traveling for 250 days, you have to get used to people looking at you funny, because I don't even have an apartment anymore, so where am I supposed to do my shit? You know, like, oh, that sounded weird. You know what I mean? Where am I supposed to do stuff? I don't even have a home anymore. So you have to kind of, you know, get over it. But there is ways of integrating movement into your day that can work. And what I try to make sure now, because I started getting back pains, is I try to do deadlifts once a week at least. So lifting something heavy in a controlled way, nothing too high intensity. And because I have an Olympic weightlifting background, I love doing lifts. But also it has been shown to dramatically increase bone density and overall health also in older people as well. So of course, you're not supposed to do like, I don't know, a 200 kilo deadlift if you're an old little lady or so. But just learn how to lift in general, because that helps you with any kind of lifting. If you're lifting like a bag of potatoes or the water box or something, but it also is good for your overall health. And if you don't have a bar, I have like a resistant band with me in my suitcase all the time that you can just put around your feet and like do like good mornings, which is like a simpler way of doing a deadlift. So you have a bit of resistance, and that dramatically helped with my back pains as well. So you can make it work if you know a little bit about what routines will work for you. And this is something I will advise people on how to do when I have like one-on-one consultations.
Thanks.
Pleasure.
Show your biceps.
No.
Come on.
No. No, 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 no. Don't make me do stuff like this.
Okay. So,
any serious questions, or can I die in shame now?
Let's hear it. For the weightlifting, agave drinking, hunting, Catherine Abels!
Woo! Thank you. Thanks.